In this session, Adam and I want to talk about worship ministry essentialism. Accomplish more by doing less. So this is kind of the thing that's been personally on my heart this year, something that I feel like the transition in this season of Church Front where we're at right now, and in just life in general, this idea of essentialism. So the problem a lot of us have is the quality or quantity of things on our to-do lists is, or our dream list, or whatever it is we want to do, is greater than our time, energy, and focus, right? Is that a pretty common problem in this room? And this is like the footage, actual footage of our worship ministries most of the time, right? It's just a constant hamster wheel, and maybe we're kind of maintaining things Sunday to Sunday, but we're not actually making progress. Like maybe you're hearing all sorts of great ideas at this conference this week, and then you get home, and you're like, oh man, do I work on the team stuff James was talking about, or Julia, or Zach, or the live streaming stuff from the workshop, and you just kind of get overwhelmed, and then you're just a hamster on a hamster wheel. So this is kind of a general solution that I have, and it can get specific how we apply this to each of our lives and ministry, but implement the art of essentialism for your worship ministry. This idea is from a guy named Greg McEwen. If you have not read this book, read this book. I would have booked him for this conference, but he's one of those guys who they just, for a living, he writes books, and then they pay him like 50 grand to show up to a conference to talk about his book that you could have read about. So I was like, hey, I'll just tell you to read his book and then kind of make his ideas my own here. No, but he's like a big, well-known like speaker, entrepreneurial, motivational speaker guy or whatever. And I could save you the 6 hours of reading his book, but his main point is this. Most people live on the left side of this image where we have a finite amount of time and energy and we're trying to do all the things at once. Therefore, the amount of progress we make represented by that green arrow is very limited because we're using up all of our time and energy to go in all these different directions, right? But on the right, the life of essentialist looks like that, where all your time and energy is devoted to one thing, and that's where you make the most progress. So let's talk about what does this mean for worship ministry, because you can really apply this to like all different aspects and facets of life. But I think a lot of our daily life looks like this on a week-to-week basis, and we're getting pretty spread thin, and this is where we get stuck in that hamster wheel, because we got all these random things that we have to do, you know, the weekly planning, tech upgrades, there's a funeral or wedding we have to take care of, there's a staff meetings, songwriting we want to try to do, self-care, and it just gets really overwhelming. So here's his kind of thesis of the book. Essentialism is not about how to get more things done, it's about how to get the right things done. It doesn't mean just doing less for the sake of less either. It's about making the wisest possible investment of your time and energy in order to operate at our highest point of contribution by doing only what is essential. There's a lot of meat in that little paragraph right there. And it's not just simply, you know, just do less, right? It's like we have to take time and reflect on what are the right things we should be doing? What are the important things we should be putting our time and energy into? That's where I think a lot of people we don't spend a lot of time reflecting on that and clarifying that. So here's some quick tips. If you're a manager in this room, raise your hand. If you're a manager, you manage people on your staff, okay? Stop hosting pointless meetings, okay? And wasting so much time. There's just like, yes, can I get an amen, all right? Because, okay, so technically now I'm in the role of manager, right? You can be honest. Do we have a lot of pointless meetings in Church Front?
We have one meeting a week.
Yeah.
And we just get it done in like an hour, hour and a half maybe.
It's like we actually had to consciously start doing that because me, Luke, and Adam, and Eric, four of us run Church Front. And as you can tell, we're the ones like even running the sound and doing all that stuff today, chuckling. We kind of force ourselves to do that to keep it simple and lean. But yeah, we're just kind of chugging along week to week. And I was like, oh man, we all kind of self-manage, but we actually should meet together once a week to like, we can actually make it more productive by meeting. So we had the opposite problem, but that one meeting a week, we get a lot done.
The other part is Jake has hired a lot of like self-starter self-disciplined people. Yeah. You might not have those people on your teams.
Yeah.
So that's one caveat.
Yes. Okay. What if, this is a nice quote, what if businesses eliminated, or churches, I put churches above businesses, because it's all organizational leadership stuff. What if we eliminated meaningless meetings and replaced them with space for people to think and work on their most important projects? Wow. What if employees push back against time-wasting email chains, purposeless projects, and unproductive meetings so they could be utilized at their highest level of contribution to their companies and in their careers? I don't think there's a lot of clarity on many church staff teams about what is our highest level of contribution for each of us to this organization. I don't think stuff is, I just like blew a spit bubble in front of me. It's like wiping out. Anyways, a lot of people don't, we don't spend enough time reflecting on that. I think a lot of our team conversations we do. Yeah. We're like, I'm like, Adam, like I look at, when I think of Adam as his manager, I'm like, what is his highest contribution? He can do a lot of things because he's a jack of all trades, multifaceted, you know, guy. He can do a lot. But we like often pause and think for you, for Luke, for Eric, what is the highest contribution activity that you can make?
Yeah. And if you guys aren't writing that question down as a to-do to ask yourself when you get home, I would say if you had a to-do list somewhere, write, spend 1 hour answering this question. What is my highest contribution to the church that I serve at? And then put it in your calendar. Yep. October 27th. You know, I don't know what date it is today, but whatever it is, like at this time, I'm going to spend an hour thinking about this.
Yep. Yeah. And then also we'll talk about this. I think I have in the slides here somewhere, but you know, make sure you're talking to your direct reports and your leadership about this. If you have a manager who is not an essentialist, tell them this when they keep giving you more things to do. Okay. So hopefully you guys won't get fired for doing this, but it's, again, this is good questions. You ask these questions to push back against the busyness, non-essentialism that keeps everybody stuck, okay? If your manager comes to you and asks you to do X, you can respond with, yes, I'm happy to make this the priority. Which of these other projects should I deprioritize to pay attention to this new project, right? Because a lot of us, we probably signed up for a job description that's like, yeah, we need to have Sunday services planned and executed to the highest of our excellence ability, right? And then some random project comes up where they're like, hey, Johnny, can you make a 3-minute promo video for Anne's Quilting Club for Grandmas that's happening next week or something like that? I mean, that's a really extreme example. But stuff like that comes up. And unfortunately, especially in a church environment, there's a lot of good ideas that are thrown out there, but there's not enough people like me to be like, no, we are not doing that. Like, that's not our mission, right? And because we have to reverse engineer these decisions to what's the ultimate mission and purpose of this place, right? And I feel like you can pull that card out when you have a manager who tries to assign things to you that's not, it's not part of like the mission of your department or your job description or whatever. And you ask them this question to make them basically verbalize that they're making you deprioritize what's most important.
Before we continue on with the video, I want to tell you about our sponsor, the Church Front Live Conference. It's a 2-day conference with keynotes and breakout sessions on topics like worship tech, worship theology, musicianship, and leadership. It is a great way to network with other like-minded ministry leaders in the Church Front community. The sooner you purchase your Church Front Live tickets, the greater the discount you will get with the early bird discount code. So head on over to churchfrontlive.com, use that early bird discount code at checkout, and I look forward to seeing you at the conference. Now let's get back to the video.
So unfortunately, churches are notorious for giving staff members a ton of busy work that doesn't make an impact. The reality is we have multiple facets to our responsibilities as worship ministry leaders. So I'm not going to deny the fact that there is stuff that has to get done. This is not a magic like switch that you just flip and then you have a simplified essentialist work life, but it's kind of a process. And part of this process is first, we need to analyze, question, and clarify our responsibilities with our leadership. So have those conversations. Like again, Adam and I and the team, we're having them all the time. and have those conversations with your direct report. Then we need to strategize a sequence for building out systems. So we like systems a lot because systems allow you to reverse engineer the ideal world that we're shooting for, where we can focus our time and energy on to our greatest contribution. Because sometimes we might identify that greatest contribution, but that more exists in an ideal world because we're so caught up in all these other responsibilities right now that it's kind of nearly impossible to focus solely on that. And the trick to get there is systems. The only actual way to accomplish all the good ideas that you have for your ministry is to do the hard and boring work of building systems to free up your time, energy, and focus for those good ideas, or those not just good ideas, but they should be the highest contribution to your organization or to your church ideas, right? So we got to get better at defining good ideas, but that's what I mean. But most people don't do this. They'd rather scroll TikTok and binge Netflix. So their ministry exists in perpetual mediocrity, right? Okay, don't be most people. So just really quick stuff. This is stuff that we've applied to my own life, in my own worship ministries. Read the book, Five Levels of Leadership by John Maxwell. Okay, I'm not gonna summarize it here, but the steps kind of, well, these are kind of the steps of it. You know, when you're in a ministry, everything has a foundation of relationship with your team members, because you can't build systems, because systems require people, and people will not go where you want to go if they don't know you. People go with leaders they know.
And if you don't give them a system to follow, if you say, hey, can you run slides for me? Thank you. And then you step on stage to lead worship, and they're like, what am I doing here? Yep. If you want to look at it, Luke has a great starting point of like how he's built out. Hey, my volunteers look at these set of pages and they know exactly what to do step by step.
Yep.
So people aren't going to follow you if they don't know you. And if you don't have a system in place, they're not going to know what to do.
Yep. And that's why the next step, like optimize weekly planning and execution for Sundays for yourself. Like all of us at some level of our journey have to develop mastery in these areas of worship ministry, even the tactical things of using Planning Center, knowing how to use ProPresenter, knowing a sound console, all that stuff. I really think the ability for someone to show up at a church as just a worship leader who leads songs on Sunday, that's like practically mega church or bigger, where you have a whole operation staff underneath you who takes care of that. In a small to mid-sized church setting, you gotta do it all. Nobody's gonna do it. You at least have to build the systems initially. And then once you kind of build them to be all cohesive and running smoothly, then like Adam said, you can plug them in to your ministry. So get to know the people, build the systems great that you can operate yourself, but then give it over to other people so they have a starting point, and you got to get the Sunday to Sunday done. And that's what standard operating procedures are, right? So what's a standard operating procedure?
So an example would be, like I said, you ask someone to run ProPresenter. You could train each individual person, say, like, set up a time. Okay, we're going to meet at the church at this time, and I'm going to show you how Planning Center works. Or you can download a free app like Loom, or just use QuickTime Player to capture your screen and just talk through, hey, everybody that ends up watching this video, this is how you operate ProPresenter. And you click through, and you do all the steps, and you show people what to do, and then everyone can watch that video whenever they want. And they can pause it and rewind it and go back, kind of like worship ministry school when I'm teaching courses. Yep. If I'm saying something that you don't understand, you can pause it and go back. And then additionally, you have some sort of document that's like the overview of the steps. Like, okay, I need to open the software. I need to click this at this point. I need to click that at that point. If I need to pull a graphic in, oh, I remember that from the training. Here's how you do that. So just having a step-by-step walkthrough. And even for us that have served at South Fellowship here and we're tech directing, you know, we have to remember to open the doors. We have to remember to restart the computers before we, you know, fire on certain, you know, audio systems or other systems. And we've optimized that as much as we can. But there's still a list of like 15 things that we have to do when we walk in, all before Atlas is open and we can get coffee. So I'm not going to rely on my brain to remember all those things in that order. As someone who has shown up here every Sunday, and I'm especially not going to ask someone that's here once a month to remember all those things.
Yeah, exactly. That checklist is a lifesaver, man. Sundays are awesome. Just like it's, we literally don't have to think about it. I'm just like a robot in the morning, show up, follow a checklist, or one of our team members, whether it's Ashton or whoever, just follows the checklist, really eliminates those headaches. So again, once you get the SOPs in place, recruit, train, delegate, and empower. Like, you want to have the right machine in place before you start inviting a bunch of people kind of into that machine, or else, because if you don't have any systems set up, you're going to invite people in and then they're just going to get frustrated and this is a clown show. Like, what am I doing here? Like, they're going to check out and leave. Whereas like our tech ministry here, I feel like has been really thriving because we have the checklist. We have all the systems up and running for all the gear, and it's a fun experience on Sunday. Very low stress, very few things that come up on Sundays, troubleshooting wise, and people just have a lot of fun and they want to be a part of it. And then that finally brings us to this place where you can have time for your highest contribution activity, whether that is being, you know, more time towards crafting your liturgy of your service or songwriting or doing a worship night, whatever that is. I think this is unique to whatever God calls us to. But the reason the systems and the boring stuff is your friend is to free you up to have the time to do these things, right? So
that's a lot of steps. That sounds like a lot of work and a time that I'm going to have to put in before I get to the fun stuff.
It is, but that's life. So toughen up and just get to work. Get to work. Man, if you guys go join our coaching program, this is what it's like. We say it like it is. You might have to also sign up for a therapist after. Just kidding. It's not that bad. So again, get clear on your what's the priority, right? It's the guy, he talks about in the book, McEwen, he's like, we talk about priorities, but that's kind of an oxymoron. Like, really, priority is the etymology of the word. It should be singular. Like, what's the one thing we should be focusing on? Talk about things like mission and vision of the church. You have to kind of reverse engineer from the big picture goals. Like, what is this organization about? What does that mean for my role? And then I also really believe in this idea of seasons. What's important to focus on in this season? Because we have this list of all these things we can do and improve, but really get the foundational week-to-week stuff right and kind of systematized well. And then maybe break the year up into quarters. I like looking at the year into four quarters. 3 months is usually enough time to really make a significant improvement in one area. For some of you, that might be building the foundational systems we talk about. For some of you, that might be like, hey, the next 3 months, let's really think about songwriting, or maybe that's a worship night or something of that nature. And then what are the most important daily tasks that are going to result in your desired outcome? Focus on the leading indicators you control, not the lagging indicators, okay? So that means if I want to recruit more volunteers for my ministry, maybe the leading indicator is, did I look up our church database and all the names and phone numbers? And this is a novel idea, really, because people are always like, Adam, I don't have any volunteers. How do I get volunteers? I've got the secret, okay? Most of y'all's churches have these big databases of names and numbers and emails. Actually, it's what Churchfront does to make money. We actually call people, right? Eric calls people.
Eric
and
makes
a lot
of phone calls.
We actually make sales. You can do the similar thing in the church where you go through those numbers, call people up, just be like, hey, this week I'm going to call at least 10 people. That's my leading indicator I'm going to focus on. You know, not, it's a little bit harder with like certain musician roles, but hey, you never know. Because you might call a person and be like, hey, it's so-and-so. I'm the worship pastor, tech director, such-and-such church. I'm just really just calling to see if anybody else wants to get involved in our ministry. Is that something you'd be interested in? And if there's like, no, I'm like, okay, great. Well, have a great day. They'll still be really happy that you called them, I think. Be like, yeah, maybe can I pray for you? Or, you know, you can end the prayer some other way.
Or maybe, I really like kids. And it's like, okay, here's the number of the kids.
Yeah, you could refer director. Them to another department and then charge that department for like a finder's fee.
Jake's right? A setter.
I'm just coming up with ideas on the fly. No, but seriously, call them up. You have to create that opportunity, right? So that's this idea of like, hey, my leading indicator is I'm going to call 10 people from our church a week and see if they'd be a fit for worship or tech, or if they know someone who might. And then if your ministry does not grow, I don't know you probably should quit at that point if you've like called that many people. Because again, you're putting the leading indicators in, right? And we talk about this with Church Front. It's like, what do we know that works? What are the inputs? It's like, okay, one good YouTube video a week, or you know, X amount of calls per day, or I don't know, just or emails, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, all you guys, you probably get my emails all the time. You're like, oh my gosh, unsubscribe. How am I back on this email list? But you know, there's just certain things that we have leading indicators that drive results. So instead of getting too caught up on the lagging indicators, which are the results, what can you control and put into it? So leveraging technology, there's tools out there to make our lives easier, build the systems, have the people. And then this is some ideas for high impact activity for a lot of you. If you're trying to look for clarity, it's like number one, developing your own skills and knowledge so you can build these systems we talk about. Developing others, that's always gonna be high impact activity. Developing SOPs and refining a system so it can run without you. And meeting avoidance. So I don't know, that's again, don't get yourself fired, but it's just like, there's so many meetings in churches, man. And I don't get it. There's Jesus. So I was like, no. Because when you read the Gospels, I really do think Jesus lived this life of essentialism, right? So he, like, and this is the chosen Jesus, so this is like the Jesus I picture now when I'm praying or something. But no, it's just so simple. It's like he shows up in Mark chapter 1, 16, 15 or 16. He's like, the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe the good news. It's like, boom, that's it. That's what drove his whole everything for the next 3 years until his death and resurrection. And again, it's just like Jesus, when you read him out of the Gospels and how they portray him here, he's just a very like, he's very focused, very like, he's not like trying to do a gazillion different things, right? He has his mission, he's his focus. So I think it's actually very Christ-like to be an essentialist.
Yeah. He even said no sometimes.
Yeah, he said no.
Like,
yep.
He had a bunch of people he could have healed, but he's like, no, I have a higher purpose and
people
priority.
People died, Lazarus, because he didn't go when they told him to. Obviously, he had the power to still raise him up later, but it's like, I don't know, he just didn't, he wasn't under the, I think there's a book called like The Tyranny of the Urgent or something like that, right?
Yep,
he,
Charles something.
Yeah, another good book, okay? So
Not Spurgeon, different Charles.
So. Anything else before we transition to our Q&A time?
No, I think anything else, we can just answer questions because I'm sure you guys have some specific ones to your ministry or, you know, how essentialism could feed into that or provide some answers for you guys.
Yeah.
And we don't have a mic runner, so we'll just, for the live stream, repeat the question before we answer it.
Yep. Yeah. Well, they could also just save the question for the panel.
That too. We are running behind. So
yeah,
we
we're a little bit behind.
Do essentialism questions.
Yeah, just do them in the panel. Because what we're going to do, let's do a little bit of a kind of another stretch break right now. So that wraps up this session. And then I think we're going to do another sponsor shout out.